Hello, everyone, and welcome to the November 2021 Legacies and Lunch, a program of the Cowles Butler Center for Arkansas Studies. I'm Heather Register Zabinden, the outreach coordinator for the Bobby L. Roberts Library of Arkansas History and Art. The Roberts Library houses the galleries and bookstore at Library Square, the Butler Center for Arkansas Studies, and the Encyclopedia of Arkansas. The Roberts Library Research Room is open Tuesday through Friday, 10 until 5, and will also be open on Saturday, November 6th and Saturday, November 20th from noon to 4 for our monthly bonus Saturdays. So please go to robertslibrary.org for all the specifics before planning your visit. So this program is not being live streamed to YouTube because YouTube is not cooperating today. So immediately following the program, you won't be able to suggest it to your friends, but give me a day or two and I will have it up because we are recording it. We haven't had, YouTube usually works for us, so I don't know what's going on today. The speaker will answer questions at the end of the session, so please type your questions in the chat box here on Zoom. Now for today's program. This month, we have Eric Juhnke to talk about quacks and crusaders in Arkansas medicine. Eric is a Fulbright scholar and professor of American history at Blair Cliff University in Sioux City, Iowa. He is the author of Quacks and Crusaders, The Fabulous Careers of John Brinkley, Norman Baker, and Harry Hoxsey. So everybody, please give a warm virtual welcome to Eric. And if you'll unmute yourself. There okay. You go.
I think I'm good. All right. Well, thank you, Heather. And thanks to everyone there at Cowles for having me today. I worry a little bit that maybe you're getting overdone with quackery. Last month, you had Sean Fitzgibbons talk about Norman Baker and his time there at the Crescent Hotel, and I thought he did a great job. And again, I want to give a plug for his book. I'm looking forward to getting a copy of it. But I'm going to talk today a little bit more about quackery. This is it's a favorite topic of mine. It's something that I spent maybe about 10 years of my life working on this project, which eventually became the book Quacks and Crusaders. So it's something that I love visiting about. Usually, people ask me, how did you get involved in quackery and studying it? And I've got two answers, and one involves just a little story, which I'll share from you, which is from my book. In the fall of 1932, Bill Juhnke, a 20-year-old elementary school teacher, attended a literary society meeting in rural central Kansas. Speakers addressed the group, outlining the merits of Kansas's three candidates for governor: Democrat Harry Woodring, Republican Alf Landon, and the independent John R. Brinkley. Bill took on the task of defending Brinkley, the controversial goat gland doctor from Milford, and gave a rousing oration on his behalf. Afterward, Nita Gehring, a 16-year-old high school student, approached Bill. "You don't really think that Brinkley has a chance, do you?" she asked. "Sure," Bill replied. "I'll make you a bet," said Nita. "If Brinkley wins, I'll take you to a movie. If he loses, you pay." Nita won the bet. Brinkley's third place finish in the November election earned Nita a free date to a Shirley Temple movie at a local theater. 5 years later, Nita and Bill married, and the union lasted 54 years and produced six children, including my father, William. So I guess in a sense, I have some gratitude for Brinkley for bringing my grandparents together and leading to my father. But although that's a family story that I'd heard many times, it wasn't really the reason that I began my research of quackery. That was really a case of serendipity. When I was an undergraduate student majoring in history in Iowa, I was forced to do a senior thesis project. And I remembered when I was a freshman and sophomore taking the standard US survey, that when we had studied the Depression, in the textbook, there was a brief mention of, you know, kind of a rural rebellion, particularly in Iowa, farmers fighting against foreclosures, farmers trying to control commodity prices, the Farmers Holiday Association led by Milo Reno, there was a Sioux City milk strike. And then there was a brief description of something called the Cedar County Cow War, where farmers took up pitchforks and clubs and resisted state veterinarian attempts to enforce mandatory bovine tuberculosis testing. And so when the vets came to test the cattle, these farmers resisted them in these farmyard rebellions and threw them off. And it became such a rebellion that the governor had to call in the state militia to put this rebellion down. So when I was a senior, I thought, man, I got to find out more about this. And so I began investigating. And very quickly, I learned that one of the main instigators of this rebellion was a man by the name of Norman Baker from nearby Muscatine, Iowa, not far from Cedar County. And Norman Baker, in 1931, when this cow war took place, he had a radio station in Muscatine for 6 years, and he had a cancer hospital for 2 years. And he had used the radio to advertise his cancer hospital and to sow doubt about mainstream medicine involved, with the testing of the cattle, with cancer treatment and so forth. So I became fascinated with Baker, and I turned my attention to him for my master's thesis. And then at the University of Kansas, when working on my dissertation, I expanded the project to include Brinkley and Harry Hoxsey, another cancer quack, all three of which were active in the Midwest during the early to mid 20th century. Now, before I think I move on, I'll give you just a little mini biography of each of these men. I use this word quack. Quack is derived from an old Dutch word called quacksalver, which is to boast or to brag about the value of one's salves. In other words, you claim to know more than you know, or to offer more than you have. But I think it's important to understand, in terms of quackery, also the element of conscious deceit. All three of my subjects knew on some level, despite some aspect of self-delusion, they knew on some level that their cures did not work, but they promised otherwise. And such behavior, I think, is the essence of quackery. Now, throughout Western civilization, of course, there have been quacks in politics, religion, finance, but the word is most often associated with medicine, and my subjects were three of the best quacks in American history. And let me introduce you to them one by one, just very briefly. Oh, I apologize, I got ahead of myself. This is a slide here on the cow war. Which took place in Cedar County in 1931. But my first subject here, John Brinkley. And Brinkley, like Baker, has an Arkansas connection. In 1917, Brinkley established a medical practice in the small town of Milford, Kansas, which is near Columbus Junction, not far from Manhattan. And he soon was attracting hundreds of middle-aged elderly men who flocked to Milford to undergo Brinkley's signature operation, his goat gland transplant for sexual rejuvenation. Brinkley figured that goats were the most healthy and virile animals on earth, and that He could perhaps restore sexual vitality and the overall health of men by giving them a set of gonads. The operation cost $750 and it had absolutely no medical value. In fact, it was dangerous. Ironically, as part of the operation, Brinkley also, he severed the vas deferens between the prostate and the scrotum. And in doing this, Brinkley was, you know, essentially performing a vasectomy. So rather than making men virile, he made them sterile. In 1924, Brinkley opened a radio station in Milford, and he used it as a mouthpiece to advertise his medical practice. By 1930, he had performed his operation for some 10 to 15,000 patients. Now, Brinkley's celebrity as a radio personality and an unconventional doctor made him extremely popular within Kansas and really throughout the rural Midwest. After the Federal Radio Commission rescinded his radio license in 1930, Brinkley sought retribution by running for governor as a write-in candidate, and he nearly won in 1930. Even as a write-in candidate, he ran again in 1932 and ran again in 1934, all times unsuccessful, of course. In 1933, Brinkley relocated his hospital to Del Rio, Texas, with advertising for his hospital booming over his radio station, which had 500,000 watts. It was a border blaster station. Brinkley continued to attract customers to Del Rio. And then he later opened another hospital, actually two hospitals, one in Little Rock and one outside of Little Rock between 1938 and the early 1940s. Brinkley, by the time he got to Little Rock and even during his years there in Texas, he was no longer performing his goat gland surgery. Instead, he focused on the prostate and men that were suffering from an enlarged prostate or issues with the prostate. My second subject, again, one who had an Arkansas connection, was Norman Baker. As I mentioned before, he had a radio station and a medical practice in Muscatine, Iowa. And in 1929, he announced over the radio that he had discovered the cure for cancer and that it could be found at his Baker Institute there in Muscatine. Between 1929 and 1940, thousands of cancer sufferers came to Muscatine by bus, by car, by train, however they could get there to be saved by the Baker cure. At the height of his success, the Baker Institute was taking in 30 plus new patients a day. Now, when tested by the AMA, the Baker formula, his cancer cure was found to be nothing more than a solution of clover, corn silk, watermelon seed, water, and carbolic acid. But, you know, he broadcast over the radio that he had cured people when in some cases, you know, they had been dead and buried. At his worst, you know, Baker, who was a notorious womanizer, made breast cancer patients parade topless behind a screen for a crowd of male hospital employees who observed the scene with pleasure. Like Brinkley, Baker was eventually chased out of the Midwest, went to Texas. He was there for a number of years, had a border blaster there as well. And then in 1937, he came to Eureka Springs, where he opened up a hospital in the Crescent Hotel there. In fact, this image here of Baker sitting at his desk there, this impressive six-sided desk with all of the latest gadgets, I believe it's still there today in the Crescent Hotel, I think in the lobby. And then my final subject of the trio is Harry Hoxsey. And like Baker, Hoxsey claimed to possess a cancer cure, which he had inherited from his father, a veterinarian who incidentally himself died of cancer. Hoxsey's cure was primarily for external cancer, and he used a mixture of common plants such as clover, prickly ash, buckthorn, and alfalfa. And he mixed it with arsenic in a paste form. Now, Hoxsey's paste did kill cancer cells, but it killed healthy ones too. These escharotic pastes, as they were called, had been used by physicians to treat cancer in the 19th century, but the practice by the early 20th century was now believed to be archaic and brutal compared to conventional surgery and radiation. Nevertheless, thousands believed in Hoxsey anyway and paid on average $400 for his services. Hoxsey ran hospitals in Illinois, Michigan, and in Iowa for a time. He was in business with Norman Baker before they had a falling out, but he spent the longest stint of his career in Dallas, Texas. Hoxsey, like Brinkley and Baker before him, became a millionaire for a time in the 1950s, early 1950s. He bragged that he would soon become the richest man in the United States. He wore expensive Italian suits, owned fancy cars, Dallas real estate, and numerous oil wells. So, these three men have, fascinating stories and, fascinating careers. But as I studied them, I was most intrigued with the question of how to explain their success, particularly if their purported cures were worthless. And, part of the answer simply comes down to radio, particularly with Baker and Brinkley. And here is an image of Brinkley's radio station. You'll see you can see by the tower, there's a crowd that's developed there. Over the summer months, both in Milford and in Muscatine, crowds just came to like a carnival atmosphere on the Brinkley lawn and on the Baker KT&T studio there, because these guys were celebrities. They were reaching into the homes of people across the Midwest and beyond, and they got their advertisements out. They also used mail order advertisements to a great extent, but they were getting their message out when AMA physicians, organized medicine, wasn't. The AMA did not allow their doctors to advertise, and that left a void for these guys to step into the breach. Moreover, radio in its early days was like the Wild West, and even the Federal Radio Commission, which was formed in 1927, struggled to, come up with regulation to govern these guys. And when they finally did get their act together and put them out of business, they simply went across the border and continued to, boost their message out with impunity. So again, part of it is radio. But the answer really for me that I found in my research was that these three were master salesmen. So it wasn't so important that their final product didn't live up to the pitch. Their advertisements, their speeches, their broadcasts had their own therapeutic value. Brinkley, Baker, and Hoxsey manipulated the fears, the concerns, and the desires of many Americans who were struggling to come to terms with some really unsettling changes that were taking place in society during the early to mid 20th century. Modernization, urbanization, the rise of big government, economic depression, of course, in the 30s, and challenges to traditional culture and to community. And it wasn't just that they were medical charlatans then. It's also, this is Baker's hospital, or I'm sorry, his radio station, a crowd outside of it. Again, they were immensely popular. And these stations were very popular. Brinkley Station in 1930 in one poll was voted the most popular station in the United States. But I argue that my subjects were in essence populist rhetoricians who capitalized upon a long used rhetorical style that celebrated the common people, pitting them against perceived enemies, such as big business, big government, urban immorality, urban corruption, ivory tower intellectuals, and Jews. So again, I'm arguing that the quack's potency is not so much in their medicine, but it's in their message. Now I have up here a book called The Populist Persuasion. This book was really important for my research. And as I tried to, I recognized early on with these quacks a parallel with some of the messages from the populist movement of the 1890s. It's populism with a big P. Of course, there's a danger of kind of besmirching the populist movement. I didn't want to say that they were quacks, but there was a growing amount of literature in the 1980s and 1990s, and Michael Kazin's book, The Populist Persuasion, was on the forefront of that, of separating the rhetoric of populism from the populist movement. And so there's a populism with a big P, and then there's populism with a small P. And it's not an ideology, it's a mode of rhetoric. And it's been used by individuals from both sides of the political spectrum, from going back to Andrew Jackson, George Wallace, the Occupy Wall Street movement, and even to a certain extent Donald Trump. In fact, the most recent edition of Kazin's book has Trump on the cover. But let's go through just some of the aspects of the message. So one of the most recognized symbols of evil in the early 20th century was the trust or the monopoly. And quacks utilized this imagery to denounce their arch enemy, the American Medical Association, this professional association of medical doctors, which set the standards for what was acceptable in medical practice. And the AMA denounced both quacks and also alternative medical practitioners, including chiropractors and osteopaths, and really tried to put them out of business. This is an illustration that was in Norman Baker's biography that I should say his promoted by his paid biography. That came out in 1936. Notice you have the tentacles coming out, the octopus is coming out from Chicago, and for rural Americans, the evil city, it's coming out, reaching into every county and dominating your healthcare experience. Baker asserted over the radio, he said, the AMA, have got a hold on you and your throat from the time you lay in the womb until you go to your grave. They reach into every home, into every school, into every college, into every living, breathing soul in America. Folks, he said, let's break that trust and put medicine back where it belongs, back into the hands of people. This is a message Baker, Hoxsey, and Brinkley all utilized. Quacks regularly portrayed medical doctors as greedy and corrupt butchers who had little interest in the welfare of their patients and the public and common folks in general. This is a cartoon from a pamphlet for Baker's Hospitals. It suggests here that school nurses were in collusion with physicians in a scam to convince naive patients to undergo unnecessary and expensive surgeries. Baker went so far as to openly charge that physicians were pedophiles. He asked radio listeners why doctors vaccinated young children in the leg rather than the arm. This was a vaccine for scarlet fever in the 1920s. And he, over the radio, he asked, is it because they like to feel the legs of these innocent little girls? Is it not a fact that many of these men use their profession as an excuse to fondle and gaze upon the nude parts of innocent children? Again, this was common for all three of my subjects. Brinkley, Baker, and Hoxsey also wrapped themselves in the cloak of religion when advertising and defending their cures. Hoxsey paid the fundamentalist minister Gerald Winrod to advertise his cancer cure in Winrod's conservative Christian magazine, Defender. Winrod celebrated Hoxsey as a man of God who healed with divine inspiration. Brinkley similarly cast himself as a pious Methodist minister. He carried a Bible with him during his hospital rounds and gave radio sermons denouncing the teaching of evolution in the schools and printed religious aphorisms in his hospital pamphlets. Baker as well utilized religious programming on his radio stations. And during his stint in Eureka Springs, he did not allow treatment to be given on the Sabbath. Although Brinkley, Baker, and Hoxsey's patients included a real cross-section of American society, rural Americans and blue-collar Americans were their kind of bread and butter. And many of them held deep resentments against urban intellectual elites. Quacks warned of highbrow doctors who confused patients with big words and scientific jargon that the average citizen could not understand. And Quacks in particular, at least my three Quacks and Quacks, any Quacks during that era, fingered Morris Fishbein, the editor of the Journal of American Medical Association, JAMA, as a symbol of upper class arrogance. Here we have a book that was promoted by Brinkley and Hoxsey. This came out in the late 1930s by Morris Beale. It's called Medical Mussolini. And you see Morris Fishbein's silhouette right next to Mussolini's, a fascist. You know, he's dangerous. Brinkley, Baker, and Hoxsey were also quick to point out that Fishbein was Jewish. And they manipulated widespread anti-Semitic sentiments in denouncing Fishbein as, quote, the Jewish dominator of the medical trust of America. Well, that's a little bit of the message. I want to talk a little bit about the patients themselves. I think it's important to get their side of the story. How did they respond to this message? What were their reasons for choosing quacks over conventional care? What I found in my research, looking at various archives, looking at court cases, and so forth, looking at letters, testimonials, affidavits, and editorials, that for the most part, the patients were not ignorant. They weren't particularly gullible. You could even argue they weren't fanatics, but rather they were everyday common Americans who often visited quacks for what you could argue were very practical reasons. For example, many people that I, many people that visited the quacks, my three quacks, expressed dissatisfaction with conventional medical care as a reason for them going to visit these men. They had bad experiences with botched operations, poor outcomes, or they were misdiagnosed. Organized medicine definitely had its shortcomings, just as it has its shortcomings today. And if you look at, particularly with cancer, the record was not very good in the early to mid 20th century in dealing with cancer. There wasn't much to offer people with men suffering from enlarged prostates other than removal, which led to various complications. And there was almost nothing for men that had lost their sexual vigor. So at least quacks offered some hope. Conventional care came up short. And so for some people, it made sense. Some people, you know, many people went to quacks after going to conventional medical practitioners. And, you know, they thought, hey, it's my body, it's my life. I should have the right. And why not? They talked to other people. They heard, other stories from other people. And there's that, you know, social proof, you know, from others. And why not give it a try? There also was the issue of economics. For some patients, the choice of quackery or conventional care was simply a matter of economics. The escalating cost of medical care had become a national concern already by the early 20th century. And by offering discounts and rebates, some quacks seemed to offer a better deal. You claim that Hoxsey is out to fleece the sucker, wrote one patient of Hoxsey's to the AMA. Yet this clinic is curing people at a small cost compared to what they paid doctors before. And, you know, Hoxsey cut all kinds of deals, gave, you know, discounts. Baker did it as well. Some people, you know, who were indigent, you know, they treated them for free. And Brinkley, as you see here with his average man's treatment, so he had a businessman's treatment, an average man's treatment, and a poor man's treatment, and just the gradations there were appealing to people of different economic levels. But you see here with the average man's treatment, it's guaranteed. So if you're unhappy with the outcome, you can come back and be treated again. There's a peace of mind in that. No conventional doctors would make, you know, such assurances. And so that was really appealing. There was also, for patients who disliked the gloominess of conventional hospitals, Brinkley and Baker's facilities in particular offered appealing alternatives. In fact, they didn't resemble hospitals at all, but rather posh health resorts. Brinkley encouraged prospective patients to come to his hospitals for a health vacation. They could play around in golf, swim in the pool, tango in the ballroom, and even taste European cuisine in the dining hall. According to one former patient of Baker's Hospital in Eureka Springs, it wasn't a hospital at all, but more like a hotel. The nurses reminded one of waitresses, they said. This here is Brinkley's convalescent hospital outside of Little Rock. It was the old Shrine Club, which he purchased. He didn't give treatments at this hospital. He had another hospital in central Little Rock. So they were treated there, and then they convalesced at this, you know, health resort. Baker's Hospital, of course, in Eureka Springs, and this Crescent Hotel. It was just a beautiful setting, gorgeous, clean air of the Ozarks. You can understand it. It's an appealing alternative than going to the sterile environment of a city hospital. And it wasn't just the location; it was the personal touch that quacks would provide. Brinkley, Baker, and Hoxsey met their patients at the door. They visited with them, made them feel welcome. Generally speaking, the word hospital gives me the shivers, wrote one Brinkley patient, but your hospital seems more like a large home where friends have gathered for a sociable visit. Practically everyone is happy and cheerful. I'll kind of finish up here and we'll open it up for questions. Another reason why I think many people went to go see Quacks was because, at least based on the testimonials and letters that I'd read, for some people, they felt as though their time with Quacks was well spent because their medicines, at least in their perception, improved their health. I read people claiming that tumors had disappeared, sight and hearing improved with this goat gland transplant for men, hair growing back over bald spots on their head, sexual energy restored. And, you know, there's issues with this, but again, they felt as though their health had been improved. And I mean, to some extent, this is the placebo effect. We've learned a lot about psychosomatic medicine and, Quacks in part maybe convince patients to heal themselves. Of course, Quacks also catered to a lot of hypochondriacs or the worried well, and many of them never were sick in the first place. The AMA and the FDA did send out undercover agents to these Quacks, and they were diagnosed, of course, needing treatment right away and billed when of course they were healthy. So a lot of them weren't sick in the first place. And also at least with Baker and Hoxsey, some of them perhaps were already cured. Many patients, as I said before, visited Quacks after already going to conventional healers. And in the case of cancer, if you have a radiation treatment, there is that period after your treatment's done where you feel crummy. And it's that curve, it's called the radiation curve, where it's not for several weeks later when you're finally feeling better and maybe your tumor's gone away as that radiation continues to work. So they had been cured or improved by conventional care, but they gave the credit to the quack who they visited after the fact. Now, all three of my subjects were very successful, but eventually they ran out of gas. It took the dogged effort of the AMA, the FDA, the legal system. Eventually, litigation did undermine them, suits, the FRC, Federal Radio Commission, the FCC, getting them off the radio. It was a concerted effort, but eventually they were put out of business. Brinkley and Baker in the early 1940s, Harry Hoxsey survived. He was about two decades younger than the other two, into the 1950s, where he actually in the early 1950s had some of his greatest success, but he was targeted by the FDA and eventually in the late 1950s, a federal injunction put him out of business for good. Well, I'm hoping there are some questions, and I'll do my best to answer what I can, but I'll turn things over here to Heather.
Thank you so much. That was a great compliment to last month's program. I feel like I know more about Quacks now than I definitely did in September. So one of the questions we got last month, which I think I'd like to hear your answer to, do you think these men believed in their cures? I mean, did they, or were they truly salespeople, business people? This was a way to make money.
Well, as Sean talked about last time with Baker, I mean, again, there is some level of self-delusion. One of the things that was surprising to me was the extent that I found Baker involved in the treatment. He didn't have a license to practice medicine, but he was very involved in directing the treatment, particularly at his Iowa hospital, and it got him in trouble. But, it showed that he maybe thought that he could, he had some knowledge and he could help these people. But again, as Sean pointed out, his advertising, it repeatedly advertised that he had cured people, which were long dead. And he also, he also made comments to some of his staff, which came out in some court cases, in which he made fun of his patients, called them fools, and so forth. But there is no smoking gun with Baker. There is no smoking gun with Brinkley, too. Again, there's some level of self-delusion. However, with Brinkley, there is a letter that he wrote his wife after he lost his second bid for the Kansas governorship in 1932, where he comes close to an admission that he got into something bad, and he wished he could extricate himself from it, but he's in too deep, and he just is going to go with it. Again, I think all three of these, to some extent, believed that they had incredible egos, and they believed they could direct cures to some extent. But no, they knew at their core what they were doing was wrong.
Well, and I've thought with both of these programs, I remember that book, and then a movie, Road to Wellville, about Kellogg and the cereal stuff.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, believing that, you know, he had all these cures in Michigan. And so, yeah.
Well, there's a great book called Cornflake Crusade, which covers that. I give a plug for that.
Okay. So Brinkley and Baker and Hoxsey, did they leave papers? I mean, where did you get your material? I mean, obviously court cases, newspaper articles, and things like that, but are there papers that they left behind?
Unfortunately, with Baker and Hoxsey, there are no papers. There's quite a collection on both Baker and Hoxsey at the American Medical Association archives, and then with Hoxsey as well at the FDA, at their archives in Maryland. The National Archives also has files on both Brinkley and Baker dealing with their radio efforts and their efforts to kind of appeal the FRC's attempts to put them out of business. For Brinkley, his wife, Minnie, who was a partner in crime, she did give papers to the State Historical Society. So in Topeka, there are the Brinkley papers, which include, letters sent in to the hospital. So it's a wonderful archival resource. They're also one of the first biographers of Brinkley, Gerald Carson. He also gave all of his research, his notes, to the State Historical Society there. So there's a nice resource. And then there are other places. There are other little archives around the country, some dealing with some politicians. The Gerald Winrod papers in Wichita includes quite a bit on Hoxsey. So you can find, piece together these things. But it's not in one spot. Unfortunately.
I love asking that question because I'm always curious where people find everything because it's never all in one spot, right? We have to go a million different places to piece it all together. So we have a question from the audience. What is the word origin of quack?
Yeah, so again, it's a Dutch word and it comes from a quacksalver. And so it's, again, to boast or brag about your salves.
That's great. What's the current status of the Brinkley and Baker Hospital building? So the Baker Hospital building is the Crescent Hotel,
right?
Correct, and it is an operating hotel.
It's operating hotel. It's doing wonderfully. I don't know, Heather. You might know better than me. I'm not sure about Brinkley's hospitals there in.
When you showed that picture and you said it was outside of Little Rock, I started kind of racking my brain to think, where is that? Because a stone structure like that, I will have to investigate. And if I know that Guy Lancaster, the editor of the encyclopedia, is on here.
Yeah.
So if he knows, where this is, or if anybody else knows where this is.
Now, this is, it was the Shriners Club. Again, it's outside of Little Rock, a few miles. Now,
Mark, so Mark Chris says it's in East End in Saline County. Someone says it's now a monastery.
Okay. Yeah, it
was that it, one.
It went through those iterations. Yeah.
Okay. I do know where it is. Yes, I think you are. Someone saying in the chat, I think I'm right. Yes, it's a monastery. I now remember that.
Okay. The other hospitals that, you know, outside of Arkansas, they've all been torn down. In fact, Brinkley's hospital, in fact, the entire town of Milford, as it was when he lived there, is now at the bottom of a reservoir. So it's, you know, all of that's gone.
Yeah, it's improved by being at the bottom of the
reservoir. Yeah, maybe.
Okay, so also someone asks, did you come across any patients who wrote memoirs of their experiences with these doctors?
Who wrote memoirs? I mean, yeah, well, many, so at the the FDA archives and the AMA, people didn't write memoirs, but lots of people wrote in, you know, describing their experiences at these hospitals with quacks. Now, a lot of people wrote the FDA and the AMA and said, hey, get off their back. These guys are helping people. But others wrote in with, you know, complaining, saying, look, you got to put these guys out of business. And so there's that record there. Now, one of the things that on this topic, one of the things that I wanted to do when I was working on this as a graduate student, it was the 1990s. And what I really wanted to do was to get more of the patient, experience, what it was like. So I wrote, I don't know, maybe about 30 newspapers targeting areas where they practiced, and asked them to publish in the newspapers an appeal from me telling them what I was working on. Please, you know, if you have any family members or, you know, to contact me. Now, you know, the problem was, Brinkley's, practice was dealing with elderly men. Right. And so a lot, you know, they were largely gone, and I just did not, I got maybe 10, letters. So it didn't give me what I was really hoping for.
Right. Right. But you tried, right?
I tried.
You had to make the effort. Yeah. So here's a question from John Lynch. He says, do we know how often Brinkley performed his goat gland surgery? Is it possible he just pretended to operate at times? And also, do you give any credence to the assertion that Brinkley might be considered or was an actual serial killer?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, on that last part, yeah, it depends how you, how you look at it. Was he trying to kill people? No. Did the operation kill some people? Yeah, it did. I mean, they had to sign death warrants there in Milford, people definitely died. I have talked to a number of doctors about his goat gland operation, and some believe that no, he didn't actually do this. It was sleight of hand. It's interesting, in his early years, Brinkley argued that somehow he was grafting this goat gonad into the scrotum. So the implication was blood vessels, and it would become something that was living. Later on, when he was in a libel, a famous libel trial, he was trying to, counter Morris Fishbein. So he charged him with libel, and there was this big court case in Texas. He was forced to admit on the stand that no, he did not graft these goat gonads in any way, that he just kind of plopped them in there. And he even said he on occasion put them in the abdomen he also, in his early years, he put some of these in women too. You know, what would happen, is they would just slough away, they'd just, become absorbed. But of course, there's dangers of rejection, infection, and people got sick from this.
Wow. And then John Lynch would also like to know, who do you consider these quacks modern heirs?
that becomes a little dangerous politically, but quackery is a multi-billion-dollar enterprise today, and I don't think there is a comparable Brinkley, Baker, or Hoxsey today, but there are definitely quacks out there, and of course it's not radio today; it is the internet. And the internet is the medium. We're struggling, to regulate it and to prevent that, that quack message from getting out in all areas, the quack message. Organized medicine is really struggling to contain that.
Yeah. Melanie McAlmont would like to know, do you find parallels with your subjects and miracle workers who did spiritual healing versus physical healing?
What I found was that, and I mentioned, religion briefly, that there was, I don't want to say a susceptibility, but evangelicals, Pentecostals, fundamentalists, they were attracted, and to some extent, they still are attracted to alternative medicine. I come from a Mennonite background, and I found that many Mennonites and Amish people who have a tradition of kind of laying hands on, that they were, they often went to quacks and actually visited, Mennonites did, to Hoxsey and to Brinkley. Brinkley, Baker, and Hoxsey were aware of these connections and tried to target these people in their mail and advertisements and over the radio.
Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking about when you were talking earlier, I was thinking about, the photographs of tent revivals we see, from the, even from the 20s and 30s, at fairs and those kind of things. I mean, it's always kind of been around. And like you said, now we've got this internet that can really get the message out. So,
There was the Chautauqua, the patent medicine sales of the 19th century. And even, Brinkley, before he discovered his goat gland operation, he was involved in some of that, traveling around. He actually was arrested in South Carolina and imprisoned for a little bit for fraud, for selling some kind of electromagnetic treatment for sexual impotency back then. So, I mean, he was this traveling itinerant, medicine man.
Yeah. I've been reminded of a question from last month. Also, are there any contemporary accounts from nurses or other hospital workers who realized they were working for a quack?
Yeah, there are a few that testified in court against these guys. And in fact, Baker in particular, in his 1940 trial for mail fraud, there were a couple of nurses that testified. I point out, it was difficult for all three men to get a staff, because AMA doctors won't have anything to do with this, but. So what they did is they often reached out to alternative healers. So they were staffed with a lot of chiropractors, osteopaths, naturopaths, eclectic doctors. and also nurses that maybe didn't necessarily have the best, you know, the best or mainstream training, I should say.
Yeah. So we have a question from Betsy Session, I guess. It looks like a Czech name. It's got a C and a Z. So I'm sorry if I pronounced that wrong. Do you include the guy who did lobotomies with an ice pick as a quack?
I think early lobotomies when that was going on, it was actual, you know, that was mainstream medicine, you know, when that was going on for some time. And there was that, I know who you're talking about. I would say there that he's probably a quack too. Yeah.
So in the chat, for everybody who's interested, Mary Lake Monastery has been, two people have put it in the chat from the Encyclopedia of Arkansas. So that's the building that was Brinkley's Hospital, that's out in East End. And I want to encourage people to either check your book out from their local library. It's called Quacks and Crusaders, or buy it from University of Kansas Press.
Yeah, it's available on Amazon, but you can get through University Press of Kansas. Yes.
Okay. So thank you so much for doing this. This was fascinating. I think we've all experienced some quackery in our lives. And so it's nice to hear it from a historic and, background that, you know, there were other people too. So thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. It was a lot of fun.
Have a great day, everyone. And next month is Walter Imhara and David Meltzer. They're going to discuss their new forthcoming book, their forthcoming book from U of A Press about Jerome and Rower, Memories of Internment in World War II Arkansas. So that's going to be December 1st at noon. So I hope to see everybody back here then. And again, thank you so much, Eric, for being here and for doing this for us. Bye, everyone.